Well, I think it's after 11. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And a happy Mother's Day. We're all here together to celebrate mothers, I know, but also I hope to celebrate our King, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, first and foremost. Let's stand together and start ourselves off with some scripture today from John chapter 15. And I know we have some still coming in. We had a quick board vote right before service, and so our elders and our board members are still finding their way in. That's all right. Is anybody that would like to be our leader this morning to lead us in Scripture? Casey Banton, go ahead, please.
As the Father has loved me,
so have I loved you.
Now remain in my love.
If you keep my commands,
you will remain.
Just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in His love.
And those are the words of Jesus. And He's saying right there, He's remaining in His Father's love. He is following His Father's commands. So should we. Let us pray together. Lord, we come this morning on a day that we celebrate moms. And for some of us, that might have been a grandma. For some of us, it might have been an aunt. It might have been an older sister. It might have been someone who adopted us. We celebrate the ladies in our lives that raised us and that loved us probably more in the model of Jesus than anybody else that we ever knew. But today, as we celebrate moms, more than that, we celebrate a risen Savior, Jesus Christ. That's who we're here about. Not a man or a woman of this earth, but the one man that came from heaven, born of a virgin, Son of God, Jesus Christ, our Savior. We always affirm that belief and that salvation by speaking the Lord's Prayer together. Let's do that today. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our first hymn today, I know you all see that Cindy's not here today. She's out on a trip with family, so I do have accompaniment through the computer. It won't be live action, but Alan Jackson's joining us today. We're going to sing Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. Let's sing together.
What a fellowship, what a joy of time, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a
text yesterday from our our neighbor up the road, Jason Chilton, to be in prayer again for his grandmother, Velma. Many of y'all know Velma Brown. She is undergoing radiation right now. She has cancer that's shown up in her nasal passages and her sinuses, and they feel very good about it, but she is going through radiation. So Velma has been on and off of our prayer list for a while, but we're going to put her back on and be in prayer for her and those who love her. And remember, she just lost her husband this past year of decades and decades, Bobby. So Velma Brown. Who else do we need to bring up today? Amanda. Sounded like a sketchy treatment.
And they were going to give her Narcan, like treat it as an overdose, but her mom said no. So they did an epidural through the IV for 6 hours.
So this is Lindy Carnell, who has been in and out of trouble with her health since she was a teenager. Thought she got through the woods in that. Now she's what? Early mid-20s and 24. Back in the hospital and has been for a good while. And she's had to go through so much of an ordeal. Miss Linda.
Yeah, I have a praise. Every year I go back to Florida and I have an opportunity to teach women, Jewish women, that have come to faith in Jesus Christ. And the last time we went was in December, and one of the ladies in the group, Jamie, her husband, had Garrett's disease. And we knew he wasn't going to last long, but we were concerned about his salvation. Jamie's husband, Steve, accepted the Lord right before he died, and the whole family. The whole Jewish family accepted the Lord.
Right before he passed. Well, and you wonder, I know that many of us in Christian churches have a heart for the Jews, because it says so in the Bible. But when we see them come to the faith, the saving faith of Jesus, that's a completed Jew, one that does have that salvation that we can wrap our minds around and understand in a way that maybe we can't with someone who has remained Jewish and has not crossed that line into Christianity. Who else today? Samantha. And which one was she? I know Amanda had a friend that had... Okay. So she did have her babies and it's good. And how about your little baby mama?
They're good.
Rachel Carpenter, too.
They are off of oxygen now. And they just have CPAP machines. And they're eating 2 ounces every 2 hours.
Chris, I noticed you're flying solo today. She's still sick?
Yes, she's not still feeling well, but she's also doing some other things.
Okay, I know that she was feeling bad last week, Heather was, and has dealt with some things since Easter, so.
She's still got some things going on there, so.
Who else today do we need to hear from, pray for? Yes, ma'am.
Struggling about the whole that loss.
Okay. you see marked in our prayer list, the Brian Embry family. Again, my cousin, dad's nephew, dad's sister's son. Mother's Day is not always an easy day for a lot of folks, and I'm sure that for my aunt who lost her son a week and a half ago, Mother's Day is rough, real rough today. And be with all of those mothers, her specifically, but others, that Mother's Day is a hard, hard day after losing a child. Others today, Harriet?
My brother Mark, that we've been praying for, it sounds like he's now accepting appointments, so he went to one Friday and he's got a couple more to go through, so just keep praying for his spiritual warfare and just his mental and physical health. And then also his wife, who is also a cancer survivor, has had some issues, and she's supposed to go back. She skipped appointments because, you know, as a caregiver, that's what we do. So she's supposed to go back Monday. So pray for her that everything's well there. And then continue to pray for Paula. She's on this morning, but thought they were coming today, but decided she just didn't want to take a chance. She's so close to her next appointment to see how she's doing. She stayed home today, but she did want to thank everybody for the food. It's been great. Mm-hmm. And we've got one more week of that. Mm-hmm. And if you don't know who you are or what date, just let me know. I've got the list somewhere.
And they really wanted to come today. And that's been the plan. And Bobby left it up to her. She just wants to do a good job and not jeopardize that. So, blessedly, we have that recording that hopefully they'll be able to see and feel like they're part of church a little bit. Not the same, but a little bit. Harriet, is there anybody online today that has a prayer request?
No, I'm just looking at that. No.
Okay. If it changes, let me know. Anybody else today? Yes, Ms. Barr.
Just a praise for Sarah, my girlfriend.
Yes.
And she's officially cancer-free.
Wow.
Beautiful. That's the word they like to hear. I mean, I saw her Facebook post on that yesterday or whenever it was, that, my goodness, you know, to think that. Beautiful. And she's been in this chapel before, so, and let's hope to get her back someday on a regular basis. And be in prayer for those. I know that right now, a lot of you have people you're praying for to be in church, very specifically. And for some, it's a hard road to ask many times and to bend over backwards sometimes to get somebody to be in church. But let's keep at it and trust in the Lord that He will have that timing for our loved ones. Are there any others today that we need to bring up? Yes, Casey.
She probably got a list, but my daughter Cassie, just kind of an update there. They put her off work for 4 weeks. The treatments are starting to kind of catch up and run her down a little bit. They wanted to rest a little bit, but at the same time, she's going to be at the end of this 4 weeks starting her new job with one of the programs up there. Her certificate has come to fruition, and she's going to be counseling.
Great.
So she's paying that forward. She's got to do it and help, and now she's going to help others.
So keep her in her prayers for the cancer and the her new picture going forward.
There was a time when it looked pretty dire on just the treatment part of her being down. Praise God. Anyone else today we need to bring up? Yes, go ahead.
I do have one more. Our neighbor, I met our new neighbors that have been there probably 6 months now, I guess. But just a prayer for them that she was really interested in coming to church, and they don't know anybody. And she's a stay-at-home mom with a six-month-old, and asked about the babies and nursery, or if there is one. You know, just inquiring, really hard for. And became Facebook friends, and then forwarded her all the Drennon information. And her husband's kind of a loner too, very quiet, and just pray for them, because I think that I think they need us.
Mm-hmm. Well, and it is a battle, and I will say on a Mother's Day, we know there are some of us, and I'm not saying some of you, it's all of us, that struggle with the fact that Many times our families want to have a get-together on Mother's Day, of course, but it doesn't allow you to go to church. It doesn't allow you to be in worship. You've heard me say from up here, well, put your foot down and say, hey, I'll be there after worship, or, you know, or you might have to get to worship after your get-together. Sometimes it's a breakfast. Sometimes it's a lunch. That's impacting us today, anonymously. It is impacting us today with folks that are wringing their hands because their family's having a get-together right now. And I pray for us to be firm and proactive enough to say, you know what, I'm going to be in worship on a holy day like this. I want to be with a family too. How about we have it when I can be at worship? And how about you join me at worship too? Sometimes they won't. But if we look at a holiday as a, well, I can't be in church that day because I've got to be with family, it's more important. Ouch. The sacrifice Jesus made for each and every one of us, I think we could probably get into the house of the Lord. Should be anyway. Enough rant right there. Any other prayer needs today? All right, let's go into a quiet time of prayer and I will close us. Praises for Lauren Hartgrove and Rachel Carpenter, both delivering twins this past week and doing well with the prognosis thus far. Takes a while, but good so far. Pray that Paula Jones continues to get better and see progress and be back and worship at the chapel as soon as she can, as soon as she feels safe in doing that. Pray today for Velma Brown up the hill. Going through radiation now. Pray for Andrea's friends, Sherry and Pebbles, both going through big things, big losses. One a house, one a husband. Pray for Mark Braden, Trisha's dad, Harriet's brother. Let these appointments illuminate what's going on so that he understands it and goes for it, the treatment he needs to get back healthy. For Lindy Carnell, for all the stuff she's going through. Again, wild and crazy things that they're putting her through. For Cassie Banta, been doing so well and has great work ahead of her. Let her stay healthy and get healthier. Pray for the family of Brian Embry, who was lost a week and a half ago, and for all mothers who are dealing with loss. Pray for those that are out today with illness that we miss, such as Paula, such as Frankie, again, just been under the weather lately. Let's get her back into worship. Pray for those that are out of worship today because of family get-togethers that there's nothing they can do about it. Not everybody looks at Sunday as the Lord's Day anymore. Put it in the hearts of those that are not of that thinking. That they need a Savior. It's in the name of Jesus we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
We have celebrations, and before I get into the ones that are about birthdays or about anniversaries, I've got one from last week that we need to revisit. Last week we had a new member join our flock, which was fantastic. It doesn't happen every day of the week. At the end. Sometimes it might be months between times this happens. We have the fourth time in 2022 someone decide to join our church family and say, this is the church where I want to be a member. This is a church where I want to work and serve a risen Savior. So I've prepared and brought today a certificate of membership certifying full membership in Drennon Christian Church on May 1st, last week, 2022. And that, of course, is to Mr. Norman Sharp. So let's welcome Norman again to our church family. And that's big time, because to say, you know, I want to be a member of a church, that's more than just saying I want to sit in the pew and receive. I want to get to work. And Norman's been a longtime church member in various churches, and it's time to put him in the service here. So, and I'm glad you feel healthy enough to be here and do that. Yeah. You know, it's been a precarious time,
and,
for sure.
Thank everybody for all the prayers for me and my family, Dennis. Thank you. Continue to pray for Dennis. Thank you.
Yeah.
And let's pray that
her health gets to the point where she feels like she can be here with her husband and her rest of her family. They're staking out, you know, a couple of pews here, which is very good. And she needs to be here with her great-grandsons and the whole family. Now to our regular weekly celebrations. I have my calendar in front of me, and it looks to me like, even though we just sang for her son last week for his birthday, Brantley number 9, we get to sing for Amanda this week. Am I right? All right, so what I have on the calendar, which may or may not be correct, is her birthday going to be on Tuesday, Brantley and Cambry? Do you know? Good enough for me, a man of 9. Is it May 10th, Brantley? Something like that, approximately? Is it May 10th?
Yes.
All right, so before we sing for Amanda, is anybody else who has a birthday this week? All right, she gets it by herself. So we get to sing happy birthday, dear Amanda. Let's sing it.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Amanda. Happy birthday to you.
Many, many more. Yes, the Brantley says cha cha cha. So when you're in elementary school, those are parts of the words to that song. I don't know how that happened. It wasn't when I went to school back in the 1900s, but you know. I don't see any anniversaries. Do we have any this week? Next week we have birthdays and anniversaries, so looking forward to that. All right. Our schedule. By the way, as I look into my bulletin and pull up the schedule, I see that we have some interesting reading for you all. Miss Jeannie, I don't know if she's going to autograph these later, but Jeannie Miskell is featured, one of our newest members. If you've never had this done, we did this throughout the year 2021. And it was almost every week somebody was featured in here. But if you've not been featured yet, please do. We'd love to be able to laugh about, I mean, share in your joy about yourself. So we do have the forms of it. So later when you get real bored listening to me preach, read about the Miskells right there. Okay. Now our schedule. This week we have Culture Shock, the study. Last week we did start the discussion about abortion. That is the topic. And each of the topics in this book have gone 2 weeks. So we'll have abortion part 2 this Wednesday, potluck meal, 6, study, 6:30. This week we have the Help Center on Friday. And is that, Harriet, is it the Help Center? It's Ron and Brenda, am I right?
Right.
Okay, so this Friday, 2 o'clock, do that. Anybody that would like to be part of that, that's never been part of it, I'm sure we can set you up in that program. We're saying right now, tentatively, choir next Sunday morning at 10. If it changes, I'll let you know. We did take off last week as we had a stressful end of the week and weekend with a passing in the family. Our Sunday school classes will be back the week after that, the 22nd. And also that Sunday, we're welcoming in the young teenage evangelists, Nate and Nick Tingle from Providence Baptist, to bring a message, which will be interesting to hear from some young folks. The Sunday after that, at 10 o'clock, we're having an Emmaus meeting. We haven't had that in probably a year. We have over 20 people in this church that have been on the Emmaus Walk. We've got at least 2 people going on it this fall. I hope that we have more than half a dozen go on the Emmaus Walk this fall, and I'll be working on one of them too. So if you're part of the Emmaus community, meet with us 10 o'clock on the 29th. If you are in town, know it's Memorial Day weekend. Be part of that. Last thing I'll mention here in this list, it's a long one before it goes further, is that we're still looking at June 4th, a Saturday, as a Cincinnati Reds day for the guys. And if you're interested in that, see me. I know there's several of you that have talked to me about wanting to go, but we'll leave that open for a little bit longer so that we can get the right number of tickets. Any other announcements need to be made by anybody? One thing I'll say again, some of you haven't been here last week when I passed this around. I've gone ahead and updated this. This is the directory template that I hope to be printing within the next week and a half, 2 weeks. If your information is correct, please circle it. If your information is incorrect, correct it. And then lastly, if you want a new picture, write "want new picture," okay? Because we don't want to put it in there. You're like, oh my gosh, that picture? Are you kidding me? Yeah, text me or email me the picture if you want it. Because several of you have already marked that. I think 3 or 4 families have said, oh yeah, need a new picture. Seriously, right now. So, we'll pass it around. Some of you already seen it. Just keep passing it. Some of you weren't here the last week or two. Okay? All right, if nothing else, we'll go on in our program. And what we have now, usually we sing a song at this moment, but I have been helped. Oh, before I do, I see at the bottom of the screen, Christian Davis. Coming soon, these evangelism opportunities. We hope if the weather is good that weekend to, again, be outside, lawn chairs, blankets, and we want to replicate an old-fashioned church on or picnic on the grounds. Bring a cooler or basket with a lunch that day. It'll be great. And that's an opportunity to bring someone to church that hasn't been in a long time, that might be scared or might say that, hey, that ceiling's going to fall in on me, you know, if I come in that building. Well, you'll be outside. There'll be no ceiling to fall. It'll be fine.
So it's service first then?
Service and then we'll eat after. So after Christian sings his last song, we'll say amen and we'll bust open our coolers and our baskets. But that stuff's coming this summer, all right? All right, for right now, I'm going to show, last year we made a video, one of our church members who's more savvy than me on the computer put together the song Mama Prayed by Alvarado Roadshow with pictures of our moms who passed on. Well, we have new people this year. So we have some new mamas in there. We also had the same idea come by a few people this week that why don't we do that for the fathers? So it is open now. Start sending me pictures by email or text of our dads who are no longer with us. They're in a better place. Give me those pictures and we are going to put those to a video and we'll release that on Father's Day. But right now, let's enjoy and celebrate our moms and just see Mama pray.
Chance to live, so I'm praying. Celebration now and get up and have our fellowship time and see folks and visit and catch up and see folks you might not have seen in a while.
We're here for Holy Communion. It's a time, like I said, we think about our mamas today, our mothers, but we are here, in fact, for Jesus Christ. Without that, there's no reason to be here. As much as our moms are important to us, if we're not serving a risen Savior, we're not serving anything. We're living in this world. We need to hope and pray that all of our mamas and our grandmamas are in the church, and that's probably who brought you to church. Let's be honest, man, it's usually not us that leads that family in the church. Sometimes it is, but usually it's the ladies in the family. We're going to prepare for Holy Communion now, and we have a hymn, I Surrender All. Let's sing along, and our servers will come up at the end.
shed for you. Do this in remembrance of me. As always, Father God, these times, thank you for all that you have done, all that you are doing, and all that you will do. It's your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
If you remember, our offering remains in the bank, and those watching online, joining us for worship online, you can send that to our post office box, Drennon Christian Church, P.O. Box 495, Newcastle, Kentucky, 40050. Let's stand now for the doxology.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Lord, we thank you so much for your blessings. The Holy Communion, if nothing else, when we're here, let us remember you, that what you have done for us. There is no salvation except through Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, period. It's not through good works, not even being a selfless mama, get you to heaven. It's through submitting yourselves to the Lordship of the one true Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us now learn more about Him through His holy book, the Bible. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated. I want to reflect a little bit on last week. Last week, I told you I had built up for a while wanting to speak about disunity in the church. We're no different from anyone else who struggles with that. Now, I would love to say we are. I would love to say, hey, there's no disunity here at Drennon. We're all on the same page. We're all on the same accord, not only in our belief in the gospel, but also in our agreement with one another to always act in love, to always act in understanding and in charity. We don't. We know that in America, the divorce rates, and many of us have impacted our own families, divorce rates are no different in church than they are out of church. And that's just one thing. I'm not here to talk about marriage today or divorce. But the fact is, too often, when we're in the church, we show no difference. We must. If we are to serve a risen Savior, we are to be different. Those of us that are big fans of the new show over the last two or three years, The Chosen, hear the catchphrase, get used to different. Because when the gospel came, Christianity is different than Judaism. And I would dare say that Christianity is different from religion. Now, if you think that, wait a minute, what? Christianity is a religion. Well, yeah, technically, sure it is. It's a religion. But if we are acting as Christians, if we're focusing our mindset, our heart on Christianity, following Jesus, we're not acting out of religion. We're not worried about the rules. We're not worried about the rituals. We're thinking, how can I serve Jesus today? What does Jesus want me to see today? What does He want me to look at in His Word today? What am I to pray today, Jesus? Because you have saved me from my sins. How can I serve people? How can I minister to those that I love? How can I minister to those that don't love me? How can I seek out people that actually might hate me because I want them to know about Jesus? Your entire existence is about Him. And then, if it is, if that's where you are in your life, other things seem to fall in place a little better. Now, I don't mean your circumstances. That doesn't mean, like a prosperity preacher will say, that your wallet will get bigger, your car will get shinier. No, I don't mean that. I mean that you'll understand better. when you suffer a terrible loss in your family, like we did a week and a half ago, that you'll hold on to the gospel. You'll hold on to salvation as what gets you through the night. Not as something just to make you feel better. Not like a sleeping pill. But as real hope. The gospel, what it says, is true. Jesus' promises when he was on this earth and beyond are true. This is why we believe what we believe. So when I said last week that we are prone to disunity in the church and the body of Christ, I'm happy and blessed to say that quite a few of you reached out to me, either by text or phone call or just when I saw you and said, "Yup, I know it. We sure are prone to that. Let's work on it." Now, I'm not saying everybody in the church lined up and said, "Yep, heck, we better serve Jesus." I'm not used to that any week. But I am glad to hear acknowledgement that you want to do better. I want to do better. I want to be excited about the fact that in 2.5 weeks, when I walk out of the door of Kenwood Station Elementary after 27 years of serving in the public school system in Oldham County, that I can come here on a more full-time basis and be ready to get down to business in a way that hopefully is more full and more real than it's been before. I don't want to be hesitant or sad about that. I don't want to have trepidation thinking, "Oh gosh, I'm scared. Be around those folks more? Ooh, that's scary to be around those folks more." No, I want to think, all right, we're a united front, like our new member, Norman. Our most recent, before that new member, Jeannie. Right before that, we had Wanda and Jean prance down the aisle together. Right before that, we had Linda and Steve come down. You know, these are the last 6 months we've had these new folks, and I want them to roll up their sleeves and say, "Okay, let's go get them." And I want all of us that have been in these pews for a while, and some of us have been here longer, way before Harriet and JR and I landed here, and Abigail and Trace, and my parents, long before we were here, and say, "What would Jesus have for us to do? Does disunity exist in the body of Christ? Yes. Can we do anything about it? Yes. We need to be open with one another. Build each other up in conversation. Never tear one another down in conversation. It travels around if you do. So today, when it's a Mother's Day time, instead of going for a sermon about Mary or about Hannah or about Sarah or about Rachel or about others in the Bible, the moms of the Bible, I wanted to continue to focus on that guy. And I chose that painting, a painting I love, and by an artist I love, Greg Olson, because there's Jesus. Now, this is him gazing over the city of Jerusalem in Scripture. But more than that, this is Jesus showing his concern for us, for his people. In that case, for the holy city. But we can take that by extension to have him looking over us at Drennon. Praying to his Father about us. What would he have us do here? This little Abe Lincoln Chapel. What would he have of us? Jesus speaks on his final night before the crucifixion about his love. If you look in the Gospel of John, the last several chapters take place that last night. And you're going through it. If you have a red letter Bible, and some of you do, so it doesn't matter whether you do or not, there's a lot of red letter pages near the end of the Gospel of John. And if you look at when is this all happening, it's all happening after the Last Supper. When Judas takes off and the supper disperses, Jesus does a lot of teaching. And this is part of it. John chapter 15, here's what he's saying about his love. He says, "As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you." These are the words that Casey led us through at the beginning of the hour. Jesus is saying, you know how he loves me? That's how I love you. Now here's a big thing after that. He says, if you keep my commands, you will remain in my love just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. Now that can be tricky. I just said a while ago that our salvation is not based on works. It's not even based on being the best mama or grandmama there ever was. And for some of you, probably the greatest model of Christian that you ever saw was a mama or a grandmama. And you might think, if anybody's in heaven, it's her. No way. But you know salvation is not based on that. It's not based on your works. It's not based on anything but the salvation of Jesus Christ, period. His sacrifice for us. But he's saying here, if you stay in his commands, you'll remain in his love. So therefore, Jesus must want us to follow his commands. Does he base his salvation on that? No. Good thing, right? I know for myself, if it was based on my works to get into heaven, well, I'm going somewhere else. It's going to be hot. Because my actions too often are not godly enough to pass muster. And I hate to break it to you, but same for you. But Jesus is saying, you want to stay in my love? You want to feel and experience and live my love? Live in my commands. Jesus wants us to be like him, to live like him, to live his way. And if you do that, you'll experience his love. Now you might counter with, well, I don't want to live that way. Don't we have freedom in Christ? Can't I, you know, just be the way I want to be? I've accepted the free gift of salvation. Is there a string attached? You're telling me there's a string attached. Great. No, he's saying that if you want to follow Jesus, if he's truly coming to your heart, you have that Holy Spirit living inside of you, you're going to want to live like Jesus. You're going to want to say, hey, this is what Jesus wants for me. I'm going to live that way. It's hard. We were talking during our Sunday school hour with our young couples about the fact that sometimes as a mommy or a daddy, you have to spell out what the Bible says to your kids. They may not like it. There's times you may not even want to say it because you're like, oh, I don't want to be that way. But there it is in the Bible. He said it. It will pay off with your kids. Moving on in the scripture, it says, I have told you, Jesus says, I've told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. So he just said, live in my love by following my commands. Guess what? You'll be filled with joy as well. I will feel joy, says Jesus, because you are following me. And at the same time, you will feel joy because you are following me. My command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. Now there's two parts in this I want you to see. One is that it says love each other as I've loved you. I just said as far as unity in the church goes, the people in this body of Christ, you need to be, quote, having their back. You need to be speaking in love to them and about them. Your brothers and sisters in Christ are going to be attacked by the world. Of course. You're dangerous for the gospel, aren't you? The devil hates you. Just about every new member we've ever had come through this church or everybody that's been baptized that meant it, when they got out of that water, got into service with the Lord, said, man, this is hard. I didn't get a new car when I come out of that water. I got a tax. My work got harder. My marriage, ooh, we had to talk through some things. My kids didn't know what to think of me. My parents didn't know what to think of me. Life's tough. And sometimes dealing with one another in the body of Christ is tough, isn't it? We're not all the same. If we're not on the same page, it's going to be hard. I beg of you, be on the same page with one another. And if you disagree on the small things, remember, we agree on the big things. The salvation, I hope and pray that we do. If we don't, what are we doing? What are we doing? The second part of this I want you to see is the part that reminds me of Mama's. It says, greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. And who on this earth exemplifies that more than a mama? I'd say 99 out of 100 times, when you talk about a mama, you talk about somebody that will throw themselves in front of a bus to save their child. That will jump in front of any robber to save their child. Will do anything on this earth ever asked to save that child, with not one thought of their own safety. And if they do have that one thought about their safety, it's the thought of, I need to live so that my kids can be safe. Not about themselves, about their kids. And even with that, with the love of a mama, that doesn't even stack up to what Jesus' love is for you. Because you know those dark times you had when you've been at the end of your rope, when you've had something going on in your life that was really bad, you thought nobody loved you, nobody accepted you, Jesus Christ was there with you. You know, I think back to the loss in our family a week and a half ago when my dear cousin was in such despair and depression that led him to do an unconscionable act on himself and his family. I thought, I know Jesus was right there with him. And the angels. And the devil might have won the battle on earth with that one. But because of salvation, he did not win the war on that. Because I believe that those who believe in the gospel will be reunited one day in heaven. I know I'll see my dear cousin Brian there. Because I know what he believed in and what he does believe. Next part of the scripture says, you are my friends if you do what I command. Now, he's getting hardcore here. This is Jesus speaking the last night before he's crucified, saying, hey, you want to be my friend? You want to be with me? Follow my command. So if you're in the camp of, well, you know, I went to water, got baptized, so I can do whatever I want. Well, technically, salvation-wise, I guess so. But my question to you would be, are you saved? Did you mean it? Because if you just want to get out of hell free card that water down Earl Jr.'s Creek, then I don't believe you meant it. Because he says, your friends, if you do what I command, I no longer call you servants. Because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything I've learned from my Father, I've made known to you. Jesus is saying, look, disciples, I've taught you what I know. You know how it is. You know what the truth is. So now I call you friend. Now, of course, one of his friends was getting ready to betray him that very night. And I'm sure Peter wasn't the only one that would have done that. He's the one that's recorded. He was the leader. And he did it three times. Jesus had to reinstate him three times in the last chapter of John. Feed my sheep. Take care of my lambs. Feed my lambs. Jesus is our friend when we walk in accordance with him. The last part of the scripture of this chapter says, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command. Love one another. Now, I know specifically this is speaking when he says, I chose you, you didn't choose me. Talk about the disciples. But I think we can go a little further and say, your salvation, if what the Bible says is true, your salvation is preordained by Jesus. Yes, you had to come to him. You made a choice through your life, through your choices, through your despair, through whatever it was that led you to him. You made the choice to come to him. A leap of faith. But Jesus knew about it. He already knew way before. He knows every hair of Wesley's head before he was even born. All the way up to dear Frankie, who's 92. He knows every hair of her head. He chose us. And it says he chose us to go bear fruit. Now, I relate that inside these walls once again with the fact that I want us to have unity in this church. Because like I said last week, and like I said in an article that was shared with me, we can't evangelize if we don't have unity in this church. We can't follow Jesus and bear fruit if we're disagreeing about our humanly wants. So yes, let's celebrate moms today. It is Mother's Day, but more than that, it is the Sabbath. It's a holy day. It is a day to follow Jesus. And I asked that of you right now. Last week we had a blessing, and that Norman not only came back to worship since the first time since last summer, in the heat of 95 degree summer, last time he felt able to be here with his health concerns and Janice's health concerns. He said, I stand up for Jesus today in Drennon Christian Church as part of Drennon Christian Church. And if you today think, you know what, it's time for me to say something like that, well, this song is for you today. We're going to sing together. Let's stand. And our last hymn is Love Lifted Me. This is a version by Eric Horner, who will be coming to our church later in the summer. And it's kind of a jazzy version, so... If Gene and Wanda hadn't already danced down the aisle, this would be a good one for them. There's going to be dancing down the aisle because it's a peppy tune. So let's sing this morning, Love Lifted Me.
I was sinking deep in sin, far on the peaceful shore. Sinking to rise no more, but the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, and from the waters lifted me, now saved am I.
Y'all, before you walk out, JR is going to...
doorway area with this big vase of roses. Be at the door if you'd like a rose as a mama or for your mama. I think we got enough. So take one at the door. Remember, they're roses. They got a pinch to them, okay? Harriet tried to take care of the thorns, but there might be a stray one here and there. Harriet, go ahead.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for our mothers and for a day honoring them. And we pray that you bless our church, Lord, and this week as we go out. Psalm says, teach us to number our days. Make them count. Let us go out there and sow some seeds of fruit